We are not so many in the audience here today due to rather dramatic circumstances, but we will keep on. Yeah? So this is, we believe this symposium is very important for the future of agriculture and for our planet. So we think it's important not to, even though Denmark is closing down at this moment, we think it's important to keep on with the science and look positively for the future and see what we can do to give the great agriculture for a sustainable way of living in the future. Yeah? And this idea of this symposium is to bring people together that are experts, worldwide experts, in all kinds of accelerated domestication of orphan crops and wild plants, and see if we can get inspiration and get new ideas and get further. Yeah? So in the case of everybody's safety, we have excluded everybody in the audience except for speakers to be here present. But it's being live streamed for everybody who is interested and will be recorded. Yeah? So just to start with my, see here if I can get, is it here? How do I get to the computer now? Yeah, we. We have the first technical problem of the day. Yeah. So now here is something. Yeah, and I don't know what changed. Okay, so here comes about short about our visions for the future. Yeah. So you. Next slide. Yeah. Okay. So the obvious problem is climate change and plant stress, because how can we get more food without destroying what we have left of nature? We cannot cultivate more land. We need to get, we are dependent on the land we already have. And how can we, in light of climate change, how do we face this problem? Yeah? So one basic idea that has come up is that we should get resilience plants for a sustainable agriculture. So plants that don't need so much input, but maybe get more eggs, give more out. Yeah? So less in and more out. Yeah? So this is an enormous challenge. How do we face this challenge? So if I can get the next slide. Yeah. So I was at a meeting last year in Lund. And some of you in the audience here were also at this meeting. And there the director of the president of the Land Institute in Kansas that has pioneered the breeding of resilient crops for a sustainable agriculture. We're talking about the progress in the field. And Fred is pointing at the specialty crops that currently are classified as those resilient plants that are on their way up. And what you can see out of the axis here is one axis there. You can see the yield per acre and then the how many acres that these plants are grown in. And maize is, of course, corn is the winner, because it's so productive and it's grown everywhere. Yeah? But the specialty crops, they are still lagging far behind. Yeah? So it was estimated by Wes Jackson, the founder of the Land Institute, that in 2010, that they estimated that commercially viable perennial grain would be available within 20 years. So that's now 10 years ago. Yeah? And perennial grain is the trade name is Kernza. His hand is just making a shadow over Kernza here. Yeah? And we will hear more about Kernza and perennial grain in a moment. But we can be sure that traditional breeding for new resilient crops is likely to take a long time. It's probably not accomplished in 10 years' time from now, yeah, by traditional breeding. So we have to realize that. And what happened now here? So the idea now is we should do it faster in some way. Yeah, but and if we should do it faster, maybe it's a good idea to take a plant that is already resilient, instead of taking our wheat crops, instead of making wheat resilient, instead of making corn resilient, instead of making barley resilient, maybe we should go take a plant that is already very resilient, but not so productive, and try to make such a plant productive. This might be easier than going the other way. So, and scientific basis for the thinking that this is maybe possible is that if you see, if we take the example of grasses, grasses have been domesticated. I mean, our major staple foods are grasses. So, but wheat, rice, corn, and so on, they are grasses. So, and they tend to, grasses in nature, they tend to drop their seeds to disperse them. Yeah? So this is not so good for yield. And we now know that what caused the genetic basis for not dropping the seeds of grasses, and it tends to be the same in every grass species we go through. Yeah? So you can see this example here with maize and rice and sorghum. It's the same kind of transcription factor that is conserved between these plants that when mutated, and it's a loss of function, when it's mutated to give loss of function, they don't drop their seeds. So then you can get the idea that if you took a new grass, any grass, and by some means could mutate the homolog of that transcription factor in that grass, maybe that grass now would not drop its seeds. And that would be just the basis for domestication. So these are some ideas some of us here in the audience presented in 2017, that we could maybe accelerate the domestication of semi-domesticated or even wild plants if we used some kind of mutagenesis methods, new methods for more directed mutagenesis. Yeah? So this is also how the idea is depicted here. So if you have an ancestral crop, this could be our wheat. And then spontaneously, during domestication, mutations occurred in wheat that gave traits that were selected for. Yeah? And now we have our modern crop. If similar genes are present in other plants, related plants, or any plants that maybe have such a gene, if a directed mutation was made to copy that mutation, maybe it would also give a domestication phenotype. Yeah? Something we don't know is how many genes we need. But, sorry, I have to go back here. So, but we got a very promising result was published by in the audience here, Taisha Gao, but also from another speaker that we will hear about tomorrow, were in papers here where they could show that they could take the wild tomato that has a berry of 1 gram and it's not at all looking like the tomato we buy in the supermarket, yeah? And by accumulating all the knowledge you have on domestication of tomato, there were 5 genes that came into focus that had been modified, that had been mutated, yeah? It seemed in the cultivated tomato. So what these groups did was that they took the wild tomato, and by methods of mutagenesis, introduced the similar mutations directly in one go in the wild tomato, and got something that looked like a cultivated tomato. Yeah? I don't know how it tasted, but for our purpose here, when we're talking about resilient plants. In one of the laboratories that of Taisha Gao, they took wild tomato that was already resistant to a disease, a Sansomonas infections, yeah? And another race of wild tomato that was resistant to soil stress. And by making these in one go, these mutants, they could get, let's call it a semi-domesticated tomato, but that was still resilient. So this is the tool. So what would be the tools? Yeah, I mean, at the moment being, we consider that the most important is to provide proof of tools that any methods in principle can be used for accelerated domestication of plants. Yeah, so we have two technologies we focus on. So one is a non-GMO technology where you screen in populations with big genetic diversity for, in principle, any mutation you can find. Yeah, so you take a mutant population of plants, or it could be a wild population of plants, and you screen for the diversity in that population to identify single individuals with the mutations that you are interested in. And this is something, a technologies that, for example, Carlsberg Research Laboratory has developed. So it should be possible in principle to find mutations in any gene if you have a large enough population of plants. Then we have our genome editing. And then here we are lucky among the audience here to have Tai Sha Gao, who were selected in 2016 by Nature magazine as one of the 10 science stars of China. Yeah, and that's quite good achievement if you take 10 to 1.36 billion people. Yeah, so yeah. So here in Denmark, we have been supported by the Novo Nordisk Foundation and the Carlsberg Foundation to go ahead with such work. And we have a project here called NovoCrops that will enable such domestication for the future. Yeah? And the applicants here, co-applicants here are Henrik Bang-Petersen for Aarhus University, Tai Sha Gao, and myself. And then we have PIs involved in the project that are Kim Hebelstrup, Rosa Lopez Marquez, Stefan Winkel, Fernando Geo Flores, and Hussam Noel-Din. And then we have a scientific advisory board of outstanding quality, and they are sitting here in the audience, many of them. Yeah. So just to finish off here, these are the plants that we are focusing on. So in the NovoCrops project, so we have two species that are already domesticated. You can say, what is the purpose of domesticating them if they're already domesticated? But the idea is to go back to wild barley and wild potato and try to domesticate them from scratch, from cultivars or from ancient cultivars that are very resistant. For example, you can, with barley, there is barley that grows in Ethiopia that is resistant to anything almost, yeah? They eat it in Ethiopia, but it has very low yields. So it's obvious to try if you can take such a super resilient plant and you can domesticate it from scratch to get a resilient barley. Yeah? The same we will do with potato. Then, primarily for fodder reproduction, that we have alfalfa and lupin, yeah, that we will try to domesticate. And with the lupin, it will maybe be the Andean lupins, that is, lupin plants that are wild, so to say, yeah? because they have a very high protein yield. You get very protein-enriched beans from lupin, but they are toxic. So part of domestication has also been to make plants less toxic. Yeah? So can we make lupin less toxic? We would have a protein source that is can grow very easily here in our climates here in Denmark. Yeah? And then quinoa is a super salt and drought resistant plant that we will hear more about. It has big prospects for a resilient plant that can grow almost anywhere, but yield is still lacking behind. Yeah? And as our big challenge to make something, to work on something very difficult, that is the kernza that we will hear about in a moment. Yeah? This is intermediate wheatgrass. This is essentially a wild plant that has been through a number of breeding efforts since the 70s, but still is very genetically diverse. So, with these words, I thank you for your attention and give the word to Lidi Han in a moment. Yeah? Thank you.